This is the October 7th meeting of the Cape Cod Commission. The time is now 3:03. This meeting is being held virtually as allowed pursuant to Chapter 20 of the Acts of the 2021, an act relative to certain COVID-19 measures adopted during the state of emergency and signed into law on June 16, 2021. If anyone wishes to speak, for those online, to click on the participants box on the bottom of the screen and then click raise hand in the text box. On some versions of Zoom, the raise hand may be also under the reactions icon on the bottom of your screen. For those who call in to talk by phone, press *9 and that will raise your hand for you. *6 will allow you to speak. You'll be recognized by name when it's time to speak. If anyone's having a technical issue, use either the chat box on the bottom of your screen or call 508-362-3828 and our technical staff will assist you. Because there are members remotely participating, we'll be taking a roll call vote on each action we take today. We are recording the meeting for purposes of creating minutes, and the names of members who are remotely participating will be announced as attendance roll call is taken. At this time, I will ask all the members to please turn on your microphones, and I'll ask our clerk, Lisa Dillon, to please take the roll call vote.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. David, are you ready? David?
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome. Fred Chirigotis?
Here.
Stephen Mealy?
Here.
Elizabeth Taylor? Elizabeth Taylor? I'll come back to Elizabeth. Tom Wilson?
Here.
Richard Roy?
Here.
Joy Brookshire?
Here.
Jacqueline Etston?
Present.
Ernest Virgilio? Douglas Fromm?
Here.
Cheryl Andrews?
Present.
Harold Mitchell?
Here.
Kevin Grunwald? Richard Elkin?
Here.
Ronald Bergstrom?
Here.
John Harris?
Present.
David Whedon? Michael Maxim? I'll check back with Elizabeth Taylor. We have 12 members present. We have a quorum.
Thank you very much, Madam Clerk. Appreciate that. At this time, we'll open up the microphone for anyone wishing to speak on any topic other than today's agenda. Just to remind everyone, if you wish to speak, for those online, to click on the participants box on the bottom of your screen and then click raise the hand. On some versions of Zoom, raise hand may also be under the reactions. For those calling on telephone, *9. Anyone from the public that would like to speak at this time? All right, seeing none, I will move on. We do have two sets of minutes that we would like to vote on and get approved. The first one is for September 9th, 2021. You've received both sets of these minutes. We're going to vote on them separately. Everyone's received the minutes. If anyone has any changes, corrections, or additions, just let me know. If not, I will accept a motion to accept the minutes of September 9th, 2021 as written.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Cheryl. And may I have a second, please?
Second.
Thank you. Elizabeth, how are you? All right. So at this time, Madam Clerk, if you'll take the roll call vote for the acceptance of the minutes of September 9th, 2021.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Chirigotis.
Yes.
Stephen Mealy.
Yes.
Elizabeth Taylor.
Yes.
Tom Wilson.
Yes.
Richard Roy.
Abstain.
Joy Brookshire.
Abstain.
Jacqueline Etston.
Yes.
Douglas Fromm.
Abstain.
Cheryl Andrews.
Yes.
Harold Mitchell. Richard Elkin.
Yes.
Ronald Bergstrom.
Yes.
John Harris.
Yes.
Thank you. We have 10 yes votes. Motion carries.
Thank you very much. Now let's move. We try that again. We'll do it for September 23rd, 2021. If there are no changes, corrections, edits, or deletions, I'll take a motion to accept the minutes of September 23rd, 2021 as written.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Second was?
Dick Elkin, second.
Thank you, Dick. Appreciate it. So at this time, we'll ask the clerk to take the roll call vote for the acceptance of the minutes as written of September 23rd, 2021.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Chirigotas.
Yes.
Stephen Mealy.
Yes.
Elizabeth Taylor.
Yes.
Tom Wilson.
Yes.
Richard Roy.
Yes.
Joy Brookshire.
Yes.
Jacqueline Etzton.
Yes.
Douglas Fromm.
Yes.
Cheryl Andrews.
Yes.
Harold Mitchell.
Yes.
Richard Elkin.
Yes.
Ron Bergstrom.
Yes.
John Harris.
Yes.
Thank you. We have 13 yes votes. Motion carries.
Thank you very much, Lisa.
You're welcome.
At this time, we'll ask Kristy Senatori to give us a report on recent staff activities through her director's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, members. It's nice to see you all today. I have some brief updates for you. We are continuing work on implementation of the Climate Action Plan. We are adding the Climate Actions database to the website very shortly. We're also working with the Consensus Building Institute on a framework for an equity working group. This was one of the recommendations and was certainly a consideration through the development of the Climate Action Plan. And we're working on developing that climate equity working group over the course of the next several weeks and months. We're also going to be convening another round of the Climate Ambassadors Program. We'll be issuing a call for students within the next month or so, with the sessions beginning in a January timeframe. We're also working with 10 towns across the region to address low-lying roads, so really looking at the infrastructure and its vulnerabilities, and this has been funded through EDA as well as MVP grants. Low-lying roads were identified in almost all of the MVP planning processes as one of the critical needs for the local communities. We also have developed two model bylaws, which you will hear about this afternoon, looking at resiliency as well as solar. In terms of looking at speaking engagements and meetings, we held two sessions to provide information to the community regarding the U.S. Economic Development Administration ARPA funding opportunities. So really identifying for the local towns and other organizations what funding opportunities exist and how to maneuver and kind of operate in that system. I'm also continuing to meet with some county staff on ARPA priorities and looking at some of the areas within the ARPA legislation where opportunities for funding can be realized and some of those proposals can be put forward. I am continuing to meet with the Cape Cod Climate Change Collaborative, and I'm on their planning team for their Net Zero 2021 conference that's coming up at the end of this month. We'll share information for with the members for that particular workshop within the next several days or so. Mm-hmm. I'll also be a panelist at the NeuroCoast webinar, which is at the end of this month, and I'll also be presenting to the Strategic Planning Conference for the Cape Cod 5 Board. Regulatory continues to be quite busy, and as you all know, you've probably been asked to serve on a subcommittee. There are many DRIs in the process and development agreements at the moment. We also have technical corrections to Chapter A, the enabling regulations on today's agenda. Those were approved by the Committee on Planning and Regulation at the meeting on September 9th, so those will be put forward to you today. We're also continuing, as you all are, to monitor COVID-19, the pandemic impacts that we're seeing, and we're also continuing to monitor any open meeting law changes. And so we'll continue to meet in this remote environment for the time being, and we'll certainly update you as plans change there. We're also continuing to work remotely, though we do have staff going into the building from time to time, and certainly on a more consistent basis. And so we're putting plans together to bring staff back in a fuller capacity. We're also updating our remote work agreements following the Barnstable County Commissioner's updated telecommuting policy that was approved last month. So we'll be updating those. We've been working in these remote conditions now for about 19 months, but there's an opportunity for us to take a look at some of those remote agreements that we have with staff and update those. And just two staff updates. We are continuing to interview for a regulatory planner position to get some help in our regulatory program. And we'll also be advertising for a new special projects coordinator to work on some housing and economic development, as well as probably fill in on some climate issues as well. So happy to take questions now or after the meeting. And that's all I have for you today. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Kristy. At this time, we'll move forward our public hearing. The commission will conduct a public hearing to consider and potentially vote whether to approve and submit to the Assembly of Delegates for adoption the proposed technical amendments to Chapter A of the Code of the Cape Cod Commission, Regulations of General Application, the Enabling Regulations Governing Review of Developers of Regional Impact, Barnstable County Ordinance 9012 as amended. The purpose of these technical amendments is to correct the Schrivener's clerical errors within the document. Its public testimony will be welcome. Just a little side note, this is more administrative than anything else. It was to correct some lettering and wording and numbering of some of the documents that were moved around. So that is why we're here. At that time, I'll move forward with staff overview with Jessica, with Aaron.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. For the record, my name is Jessica Wilgus and I'm Commission Counsel. And as Kristy and the Chair have already mentioned, these technical amendments are purely clerical in nature. You may remember the last time that we streamlined the enabling regulations. We removed some of the sections within it. And the result of that was that some of the internal pagination within the document was moved, and some of the numbers within there don't reflect that. So essentially, there are some updates to some page numbering and some lettering, but it is purely administrative. As Kristy has mentioned, this has gone before your Committee on Planning and Regulation, who unanimously recommended that you adopt this. There are no substantive changes to the document, and we recommend approval of the amendments. Next slide, please. So in terms of process, because it is a Barnstable County ordinance, you need to approve this document and then recommend it be introduced as an ordinance by the Assembly of Delegates, who will then also conduct their own public hearing and send it to the Barnstable County Commissioners for their signature. So today, after the public testimony, we will ask for a motion for you to approve these changes and send it on to the Assembly of Delegates. And that's all I have, unless there are any questions, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much. So at this time, does any commissioner have any questions they might want to pose on this?
No.
Ask you to raise your hand. Seeing none, I'm just going to move forward. Public testimony, I'll begin with any public officials as applicable. If anyone from the public would like to speak on this, for those online, click on the participants box on the bottom of your screen. Click raise hand in the text box. For some users, raise hand may be under the reactions button on the bottom. For those on phone, press *9. I'll recognize you by your name or number, and *6 will unmute you to talk. So is anyone in the public would like to speak towards this? I am seeing no one. Public officials, anyone from the public Okay. All right, I will close public testimony at this time. Ask for any members that would like to speak. As I said before, this is mostly administrative, clerical, but anyone wishing to speak, have any questions? All right. Seeing none, I will move to close the public hearing on the amendments. If someone would like to make that motion, and let me know your name when you speak and make the motion, please.
Elizabeth, so moved.
Okay, Elizabeth, I have a motion. Do I have a second, please?
A second.
Stephen Ewing.
I've got Stephen doing a second. Thank you very much. So at this time, we'll do a roll call vote to close the public hearing for the technical amendments, Chapter A. Lisa?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Tiragotas?
Yes.
Stephen Mealy?
Yes.
Elizabeth Taylor?
Yes.
Tom Wilson?
Yes.
Richard Roy?
Yes.
Joy Brookshire?
Yes.
Jacqueline Etston?
Yes.
Douglas Fromm?
Yes.
Cheryl Andrews?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Richard Elkin?
Yes.
Ronald Bergstrom?
Yes.
John Harris?
Yes.
Thank you, members. We have 13 yes votes. Motion carries.
Thank you very much. So at this time, I'll move forward with a ask for a motion to move to approve the and submit the technical amendments to Chapter A of the Code of the Cape Cod Commission Regulations of General Application, the enabling regulations governing developments of regional impact, to the Assembly of Delegates for adoption as an ordinance. Would someone like to make that motion, please?
So move.
That was it, you, JP?
That's me.
Thank you, sir. And a second, please?
Second, Joy Brookshire.
Thank you, Joy. So at this time, with a motion and a second, I'll move forward with a vote on this to approve and submit these technical amendments to Chapter A to the Assembly. Lisa?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Tiragotas?
Yes.
Stephen Mealy?
Yes.
Elizabeth Taylor?
Yes.
Tom Wilson?
Yes.
Richard Roy?
Yes.
Joy Brookshire?
Yes.
Jacqueline Etston?
Yes.
Douglas Fromm?
Yes.
Cheryl Andrews?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Richard Elkin?
Yes.
Ron Bergstrom?
Yes.
John Harris?
Yes.
Thank you, members. We have 13 yes votes. Motion carries.
Thank you very much. Moving forward to our next item, model bylaws for climate resilience. Staff will review two new model bylaws development to support the implementation of the Cape Cod Commission Act plan, including a model coastal resiliency bylaw and a model bylaw for large-scale ground-mounted solar voltaic installations. And that will be Heather and Jessica.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Heather McElroy, Natural Resources Program Manager at the Commission. Very pleased to be with you all today and sharing an overview of this work with you. So just getting right into it, we received a coastal resilience planning grant from the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs a couple of years ago now. And the purpose of that was to really respond to a need that we'd identified in a number of our communities coming out of our MVP planning work with them about development pressures that they are experiencing in coastal resource areas, specifically in floodplains. So there were several tasks identified in this grant, which included sort of developing a package of best management practices, looking at the specific needs within each town's regulations for addressing some changes with regard to their development regulations. And then more specifically, the development of a model wetlands bylaw, which is what I will talk about today. And just, you see here at the bottom of the screen, the work was funded by the Executive Office of Energy and Environmental Affairs. So just to note that, and we contracted with a team that included the Urban Harbors Institute, Noble Wickersham and Hart, a legal firm, as well as the Woods Hole Group, which is a coastal engineering firm here on the Cape. And they were a great team. I really was very pleased with that group because they brought, I think, in many ways, a unique set of skills to this particular task. So I'm going to focus on the bylaw specifically. As you may know, flood protection is protected under the Wetlands Protection Act. It is defined in Massachusetts in the Wetlands Protection Act as land subject to coastal storm flowage and as a resource area. However, to date, there are very few performance standards for flood protection under the Act. And the regulations that do exist rely on FEMA flood maps and do not consider any future risks. So FEMA is, those flood maps are established based on the storm of record. They don't look to the future and what might happen under climate change and with sea level rise. They also rely on delineations of wetlands based on currently observable conditions and again, not on future conditions. So this bylaw is forward looking, and I think that's one of the real benefits of it. So as a little bit of context, the Department of Environmental Protection has intended to issue performance standards related to work in land subject to coastal storm flowage. You see it here as LSCSF. I maybe for simplicity may refer to it that way. You can also think of that as the FEMA flood zones, which is the 100-year floodplain. These are all very similar areas on the land under the current definition of LSCSF. But the purpose of the bylaw is to give our towns additional mechanisms to address current and future flood and climate risks. So this model bylaw will provide options for adding additional performance standards within LSCSF, expanding jurisdiction beyond LSCSF, and adapting the new standards to local needs. And maybe I'll just note here that this model bylaw is in keeping with others that the Cape Cod Commission has developed over the years. In its format, it provides a menu of options. It provides some recommended language, details, it provides some explanatory language, providing some, you know, benefits or things to think about associated with language. And in the case of this bylaw, provides some options, which I'll touch on a little bit later. So the other thing to keep in mind, and the consulting team was delved into this in depth, is that in Massachusetts, the Massachusetts State Building Code really rules and local floodplain regulations cannot regulate or restrict the use of materials or how buildings are constructed. That's all handled under the building code. So a wetland bylaw such as this can put regulations in place to protect wetland resources from development impacts, but it cannot regulate how buildings are constructed within those resource areas. So the idea with this bylaw is to extend the jurisdiction beyond that defined by LSCSF. So that land subject to coastal storm flowage is land subject to any inundation caused by coastal storms, up to and including that caused by the 100-year storm, the storm of record. However, this bylaw is adding the purpose of it really is to allow communities to extend that flood area, that regulatable area, to an area identified by the best available coastal flooding model for a specific target year. And I will define that in just a moment. It's also looking at the buffer zones of other wetland resources areas located within that floodplain area. So I'm just gonna take a sort of a tangent here for a moment to explain what that best available floodplain projection model really is and what it's based on. So as I noted, part of the team included the Woods Hole Group, and Woods Hole Group was a member of a team working with others for the state to develop what's called the Massachusetts Coastal Flood Risk Model, or MCFRM. And this is presently considered sort of state-of-the-art projection for what we may anticipate being the new floodplain under different climate scenarios. So what we see here is, I've borrowed a few slides from the Woods Hole Group, and I'm not gonna touch on everything in these slides, but the point really of this one is that there are a variety of climate change scenarios, and they result in different projections for potential flooding under different target years. And the MCFRM has incorporated a couple of these different projections to sort of bracket their model. So they're not relying necessarily on the intermediate high scenario. They're using some bracketed information up from those projections that are based on data taken from both the Boston tide gauge and the Woods Hole tide gauge for Cape Cod communities. So this image is helps us visualize what might happen during a typical storm event. In this case, it's a nor'easter, and typical flood models are what are sometimes referred to as bathtub models. So basically it's representing that ocean water all coming in and inundating our inland areas at an even level. However, that's not how storms function or operate. There are all kinds of factors in play. You've got the wind, waves, tides, currents, all interacting with the geography of the land to influence the depths at which and the extent to which flooding is going to occur in a given area. So the Woods Hole Group developed this model with those kinds of considerations in mind. They've incorporated a whole number of storms, sea level rise, details of the landscape, elevations, and those climate change projections. And I'm not gonna attempt to explain how all of that happens, but it goes into their model, resulting in their ability to predict some flood probabilities, duration, inundation depths, how winds and waves will be affected, and more specifically flood pathways, volumes, and how that all plays out on the land. And the result of all of that is the ability to provide us with these projections. We're looking at the town of Dennis here, These are the inundation probabilities under the present day conditions, according to their model, which is going to be a little bit different from FEMA flood maps, even for the present day, just based on the model. However, as I scroll through here or click through, we now see the projections for 2030 and how the flood extents and the probabilities change, those probabilities indicated by the different colors. Here we are in 2050 and in 2070. So the value of this model is that at different points in time, we go back to 2030, for example, within 10 years, the probability of seeing some flooding in some of these more inland areas is heightened just based on what is anticipated under climate change. So then how does that translate back to our bylaw? So returning back to the bylaw from that little moment away to talk about the MCFRM, the bylaw is designed to allow towns to pick a target year, that 2030 projection year, or 2050, or even 2070 if they want to plan that far out, and then apply the regulations to the flood extents that are predicted by that target year by the model. So this graphic hopefully provides a little bit of an illustration of what's happening. You have the existing FEMA floodplains shown in the hatching on this image. The different MCFRM projections go from light to darker, going from near term to, you know, far out in time. So further out in time, you know, the town of Sandwich, is a little snapshot of the town of Sandwich, might see flooding in much more inland areas that don't experience it now or you know, might not under current flood conditions. And then you also see the structures that might be affected by that flooding as well. So the bylaw will utilize that, some reference to that model or another model if the town prefers. And then it will also define these sub areas where regulations vary a little bit. There's the velocity zone. Many of you may be familiar with that idea within existing floodplain terminology. You have the V zone and the A zone, velocity zones being where wave heights are above 3 feet, and where you might really experience a lot of destructive wave action, erosive wave action. And then there's some new terminology that DEP is developing actually and adopted in this bylaw called the moderate wave action area, where wave heights are between 1.5 and 3 feet. And then also the minimal wave action area. So the MOA and the MIWA will be new terms that we may be seeing in the near future. And this graphic hopefully helps illustrate those concepts. You have the V zone and the A zones. The DEP has been working on some new regulations for LSCSF. They have not brought those regulations forward. We actually thought in the development of our bylaw that that DEP would be bringing those forward for public comment, but we haven't seen them yet. But we do know some of the terminology that they have been considering, and so the bylaw is built with that in mind. And this shows where that MOA area is. It's within that coastal A zone and the MIWA. So these different separations will help you understand how the bylaw is built a little bit. So there are also sub areas within the coastal resiliency zone, this overall area that is being regulated in the bylaw. again, regulated slightly differently. There are redevelopment sites, areas that are considered highly developed. This is an area that DEP intends to define. And then an area that our consultants have defined here in this bylaw, unique to our bylaw, is the special transitional area, which is meant to get at some concerns we heard from our communities about how to address development in areas where they know coastal resources will be migrating to. So salt marshes, as sea level rises, hopefully will be moving landward to keep up with that sea level rise. Dunes and beaches will also be moving landward, and the special transitional area takes those interests into account. This graphic hopefully helps illustrate those ideas to some extent. The LSCSF, this area shaded in gray, is again that area that has been defined for some time under the Wetlands Protection Act as the regulatable area. Through the bylaw, towns would be able to define out to the dotted line this coastal resiliency zone, which recognizes that there is the potential for flood extent out to that dotted line. And then we also have the special transitional area indicated here. I'll return to that in a few slides. So I'm not going to go into a lot of the details of the standards, but generally the idea is that activities within that regulatable area, the CRZ, the coastal resiliency zone, should not increase flood elevation or velocity, should not increase flows or cause channelization of floodwaters onto neighboring properties. They should avoid or mitigate adverse flooding effects that might prevent the retreat of the flooding and the tide after the storm event. And in general should preserve soils, vegetation, and other natural conditions that provide important buffering to our communities. There are some additional performance standards within the V zone that relate to new construction. In the V zone, really, there should be no new construction. That's not a suitable area for new development. And if substantial repairs or renovations are considered on a building currently in the V zone, then it should be elevated 2 feet above base flood elevation. And then for that moderate wave action area, the MOA, really that subset of the A zone, where you're not having the highest wave heights, but you're still having considerable flooding, new construction could be allowed. Again, it would have to be built 2 feet above base flood elevation, and avoiding channelizing of flooding, et cetera. And then also, without going into too much detail here on all of the sub areas, but just to note that on redevelopment sites in highly developed areas, there are additional provisions that a community could adopt to address those considerations. So again, the special transitional area, the concept here is that coastal resources such as salt marsh are, if topography and other conditions allow, are going to migrate landward, sort of perpendicular to the resource area. And there are provisions within the bylaw that are optional for towns to adopt, which would regulate new development within that special transitional area as well. In addition to those options, towns can either opt to make this bylaw a little bit more aggressive or a little less aggressive, depending on their particular interests and needs in town. And starting with, which target year they decide to regulate to. So this this selecting a target year, 2030, 50, or 70, relates back to the Massachusetts Coastal Flood Risk Model and the extent of projected flooding. There are other options that are detailed here, and I won't go through them right now in the interests of time, because I've probably taken longer than I should have, but I'll stop there and happy to try to answer any questions anyone has.
Thank you very much, Heather. Any questions from anyone? There's a lot of information here. If anyone wants to raise their hand.
Yes.
Go ahead, Dick.
If a town is interested in starting this process, about how long do you think it would take for the planning board and the relevant boards to study the issues before going before town meeting?
Yeah, that's a great question, Dick. I think that will vary by town. You know, I think there are some communities who wanted to take this up right now. They might be able to have the discussions they want to have, you know, together with, you know, public hearings to hear public comment in order to get it onto a spring town meeting. But I think that that would be probably, would be an aggressive schedule and probably would be more prudent to spend a little bit more time building support within the community. And to that end, part of the project that I didn't touch on here, but accompanying the model bylaw, we developed a communications framework for the four towns that we worked with on this project. And the communications framework is a really great document, which could be translated, I think, easily to other communities, but was specifically built for the four communities we worked with to help them target specific groups in town, to help them understand the issues, it provides language and messaging that will help communicate the issues and hopefully improve the dialogue in town before a community starts the process of adopting the bylaw.
Thank you. Has Heather, has this been sent out to all the towns and to businesses, et cetera, the general public for review and comment?
So we, as I just sort of alluded to in my response to Dick Elkin's comments, but I didn't mention specifically at the outset, we had four partner communities for this project overall. They included Bourne, Sandwich, Brewster, and Eastham. And we developed the communications frameworks for those four communities. We delivered the communications frameworks, the bylaw, and some other materials to each of those towns and have offered to work with them to provide technical assistance as they, you know, take next steps. And side note, I'm working with the town of Brewster to set up a meeting along those lines. We just today actually have been in touch with the Mass Association of Conservation Commissions about presenting at the spring annual conference that they put on, and we see that as an opportunity to share this information.
Oh, thank you. I just had two other questions. I thought that I heard or read, excuse me, in the last few months that the state had, been more lenient and was leaning towards allowing armoring of banks. Has that stopped? Because that totally screws up the whole coastal transport. And is that still happening or being allowed or not?
I do not have any direct knowledge of that, Elizabeth. So I I'm not sure that I can comment on it. I would be very surprised.
Okay. My other question was, as everything has to move away from the coast or possibly go up on stilts, which isn't always possible, what happens to those properties? Have the state or federal government gotten involved at all? Is the state considering, you know, purchasing coastal properties, or have the towns thought about that? A lot of times it's private properties, but sometimes it's municipal properties. What happens when the land isn't usable anymore?
Okay, so beyond the, you know, the ability to put things on stilts when it seems that properties are actually flooded and not usable on a, you know, on a daily basis, is that what you're getting at?
Yeah, when, I mean, putting something on stilts may work, but if you can't get there in the first place because everything's been flooded or is no longer accessible, what happens to the property?
Yeah, I don't have a good answer for that. I think that that is something that we'll all have to wrestle with moving forward. For the time being, we're not quite there yet, and it's step by step. You know, we've got our own standards within the regional policy plan that are discouraging new development within coastal resource areas. Hopefully, communities are beginning to adopt regulations such as this, which give them better ability to address redevelopment and new development in those coastal resource areas. There was a consideration for funding to acquire properties that were vulnerable, but you know, if from what I recall, there was maybe $10 million, which isn't going to go very far. So that's really not a great long-term strategy either. So it will be an ongoing conversation about how best to address that issue.
Okay, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Elizabeth. Cheryl?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Heather, thanks for the presentation. It was very clear, and having the joy of living and working where I live, I'm familiar with all the terms, at least the ones that we've had up to date. My question is more kind of a big picture question. The word coastal predominates the title of the bylaw and your presentation, and yet we all know that we're dealing with flooding that's also freshwater sourced, you know, primarily rain. And so my question to you is, are we dealing with the freshwater flooding issue completely in a different part of our, you know, framework? Because, and if so, where do we deal with it? I know it was mentioned early on in the meeting by Kristy. And it, are we separating the two issues because of the granting source, or just the fact that it's seawater?
Yeah, no, that's also a great question. For this project, I think we were responding. So in proposing this particular project and seeking this funding source, we had heard from our communities about development impacts in the coast specifically. And that was sort of how we cast this particular proposal and the result. And you're absolutely correct. It focuses on coastal resource areas. To that end, the Woods Hole group who developed the MCFRN, that model does not consider upland sources of flooding and freshwater flooding. So that is something I think that could come later, because I think we all recognize that rainfall patterns have changed and we're getting more intense storms that result in more inland flooding that's really disconnected from the coastal issues. So I think for the time being, this addresses coastal issues. I think that as we move forward with more information about what new rainfall patterns are going to bring, there will be better integration. An area that I have not explored enough but might be of interest is RMAT, which I'm forgetting exactly what it stands for, but this, the state put together a team, the RMAT team, which has issued guidelines on basically how to better design infrastructure to address these changes in our climate. And I believe it also think it considers the freshwater, the stormwater impacts.
Okay, thank you. And you took it in the direction I think I'm thinking about and a lot of us are thinking about, which is infrastructure. I mean, when we get flooded downtown here because of a high tide and a bad storm, the primary impact is on private property and then sometimes even our town hall. Whereas when we get these massive rainstorms, the impact on the highway and the traffic patterns is, and the bridges, of course, but mostly the highways, it's unmistakable. So I'll be interested in seeing where you take this because we have our hands full on both levels. So, okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Cheryl. Joy?
I remember years ago when we were first acquainted with floodplain maps and all, people were so upset because their insurance went up considerably. And there were many, many bus trips to the State House in Boston with people protesting the cost of protecting the environment. How do you not separate the economy from the environment? Because as good as these plans are, they will have an adverse effect on many people in these four towns to begin with. So how do you convince a homeowner whose backyard is suddenly part of a floodplain map that that's not going to hurt him, that it's going to benefit him in the long run?
So if your question relates to insurance, this new jurisdictional area that this bylaw suggests could be adopted wouldn't affect insurance rates because it's FEMA determines that based on their own modeling. And so the regulations would apply to it would affect people in their ability to expand activities on their own property. And I think that's where the education element needs to come in and where the communications framework that we developed may be helpful, because it's helping homeowners understand that not only are their homes potentially at risk, but if development on their property is damaged, then that puts others at risk as well as the environment that we all rely on. So it's definitely an important issue that's going to require education, and it's going to be a slow process, but a necessary one.
It's going to be hard to convince some people that they're going to benefit from this in the long run. You've got your work cut out for you, unfortunately.
Heather, thank you very much for the presentation and for answering the questions. Just to remind everyone, this has been posted on the Cape Cod Commission website. So if you have any questions, you can always view that there and also reach out to Heather or any of the staff as always. So thank you again, Heather. Appreciate that. Anyone have any new business they'd like to bring up at this time? Yes, Heather, I'm sorry.
So I'm sorry, the Jessica Rempel also has a presentation on solar bylaw. If you still have the wherewithal for another great presentation.
We always do.
Sorry about that. I just couldn't unmute or turn on my video, but now I am. So thanks. That was a great presentation by Heather. And yeah, I'm happy to be here presenting on the model solar bylaw. Let's see. Now I don't have the bylaw up anymore. Are you all seeing my presentation?
Not yet.
Yes. Okay. Hold on. I think it's starting here. There we go. Can I just get a confirmation that everybody else is seeing that?
Yes. I'm seeing it, so yes.
Great. Thank you. All right, so I'm going to present on another model bylaw that commission staff have been working on. And this is a model solar bylaw for large-scale ground-mounted solar photovoltaic installations. And I just want to start by acknowledging that this was a group effort. Lots of staff contributed to this, including all of our natural resources, water resources staff, planning departments, and as well as Jessica Wilgus, our legal counsel and outside counsel. So lots of eyes on this, and it's been kind of a fun project to work on. And some of you may be wondering, you know, why are we developing a model bylaw? You may be familiar with in your own town that there is some form of as of right solar zoning or bylaw language, that zoning may be mapped. And a lot of this is associated with Cape Cod communities becoming green communities. And this map on the left on the screen shows the green communities that have been designated in the Commonwealth since April 2021. And the table on the right just shows the towns on Cape Cod that have been designated green communities. My understanding is that the remainder are working towards green communities designation, the dates and whether they have as of right solar zoning or bylaws and whether that's mapped. So a lot of work has already been done here. And there's two criteria that communities have to pass to become a green community. One is to pass that zoning to designate as of right locations for renewable energy, not just solar, but some form of renewable energy. And then also to adopt expedited application and permitting for those facilities. So many towns on the Cape have done that to meet that green communities designation. In the meantime, in 2014, some model bylaws for large-scale solar came out, one from the Department of Energy Resources and one from the Metropolitan Area Planning Council. Again, these seem to be in response to communities wanting to get green community designation and needing to do this zoning and permitting requirements. So those are out there. And a lot of the language in the existing bylaws in the Cape Town that have them reflect or mirror the language in these models. So, you know, in the meantime, we've seen a lot more solar development and maybe more solar development more rapidly than some people anticipated. And a lot of that is being driven by legislation and policies at the federal, state, local level. I just have a couple of them listed up here. You know, most of you are probably familiar now with the Massachusetts 2050 decarbonization roadmap that really emphasizes how the state has to transition off of greenhouse gas forms of energy, emitting forms of energy to renewable forms of energy. And then, of course, we have our Solar Massachusetts Renewable Target or SMART program, which is an incentive program to promote solar development in the Commonwealth. So these are really driving, you know, more and faster solar development. But what we're also seeing is that this is causing some concern because the development of solar means, you know, potential conversion of otherwise undeveloped lands to this new form of development. And Mass Audubon puts out this report, Losing Ground, about every 5 years. And it tracks the number of acres developed. And in the past, as shown in the graphic here on the right, that generally has tracked with new housing development. But more recently, there's been sort of a disconnect or a decoupling between acres developed and new housing. And they've attributed that to solar development. And so their study shows that about 6,000 acres of land, previously undeveloped land, have been converted to solar since 2012. And another thing that's come up more recently is, you know, a lot of people are saying, you know, where are these solar fields? We need to have a map of them. So there's a couple of maps that came out recently, one from Clark University and another from the Department of Energy Resources, that map out the larger ground-mounted solar facilities. And those are all shown here in the red dots. So you see that there are quite a few of them out there. And I just wanted to mention that the red dots that you see on the Cape, you know, most of our larger solar developments on the Cape so far have been the ones that have been going on our capped landfills. So the other thing that's been happening is as more solar is developed in the Commonwealth and as towns are saying, well, wait a minute, you know, maybe we don't want them here, we don't want them this big, or, you know, we want to do something about them. If they don't have zoning or bylaws in place, or if they do, but they don't apply them appropriately, they've been kind of running up against the Zoning Act. And I'll just read a little bit from the Zoning Act language. And it states that no zoning ordinance or bylaw shall prohibit or unreasonably regulate the installation of solar energy systems, except where necessary to protect the public health, safety, and welfare. So there have been some land court cases, and in general, they've been finding in favor of the solar developers because, you know, local regulations have been, you know, misapplied or misinterpreted. So that's something to be very mindful of, and we were as we developed this. And so all of this has kind of led up to, you know, a lot of people being concerned about, you know, the loss of forests or farmlands to put up solar facilities. And these are just some headlines from some online news articles. You know, I see this all the time because I'm following this topic. And, you know, there's just this constant, you know, conversation ongoing about, you know, where's the balance? Trees or solar? Is it worth it? You know, what are we doing here? So it's really important that we have appropriate planning and regulation in place. And so what's happening here on the Cape, as I mentioned, a lot of our solar development, especially larger scale, you know, has been happening in places where I think we'd all agree are more appropriate, such as our landfills. And then we do have some good examples of, you know, commercial projects on rooftops and parking lots. But we certainly have been seeing our fair share of greenfield development on the Cape as well. And many of you have been involved in some of the DRI project reviews for some of these. And so towns are taking kind of a new look, a fresh look at their solar zoning bylaws and, you know, working in language to see, can it be a bit more restrictive or prohibitive while still respecting the Zoning Act to, you know, protect a community's character and their natural and cultural resources. And one of these assessments was done for the town of Athol, and itself was an assessment of many solar bylaws throughout the Commonwealth. And I will just note the first author there, Liz Kellum, was at Tufts at the time, but is now with commission staff. So she was one of the planning staff that helped with the development of our model. And also in the meantime, in 2020, the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission came out with a solar best practices guide. And this includes some model bylaw language. And I should note that, you know, these are both off-Cape communities, you know, representing off-Cape communities. And there is a lot, you know, we're not seeing as much solar development as some of our towns off-Cape are, but these are great resources that we were able to tap into. And of course, here we do recognize in our regional policy plan that climate change and renewable energy siting and regulating are two challenges facing the region. So we did include in the regional policy plan our a couple of action items to develop a GIS analysis and to do some technical guidance around solar planning. So just briefly, I'll touch on the GIS analysis. I think most of you are familiar with this. We did this last year. It's been out for a while. We call it our solar screening tool. It was a GIS analysis. And what we did is essentially relate built features and natural features at the parcel level to each other to find locations or identify locations on the Cape that may be more or less appropriate for large scale solar development. So that's all I'm going to say on that. It's out there. Hopefully you've all been able to take a look at it. Let me know if you have any questions on that, if you get a chance to look at it. And then, you know, through the climate action plan stakeholder engagement process, you know, we were hearing from stakeholders the same concerns about, we know we need solar, we know we need renewable energy, but we also are concerned about our trees and our soil and, you know, the competing interests here. So a recommendation from the climate action plan was to develop a model bylaw for siting large scale solar projects. And that's what we're presenting on today. So before I get into some of the details, which again, similar to Heather, I'm not gonna get into too much detail specifics about the language in the bylaw, but just I'll highlight a few things. But I did wanna spend a little bit of time on the background section. So this was actually the last section we worked on, but I think it's really important. It sort of brings right up front why we developed this model bylaw and sort of summarizes all the things that I just talked about, that, you know, we're acknowledging, you know, that the climate change is here, we need to make this energy transition. You know, there are these federal, state, other policies and legislation that are driving, you know, more and rapid development of solar. But we also need to be aware of those public health, safety, and welfare provisions, and think about those in terms of the beneficial services that our natural and working lands provide. And I just wanna, in one slide, kind of capture that. And this is, you know, really true of any type of development. This isn't specific to solar by any means, but it's an important reminder of like why we're thinking about, you know, protecting our trees and our soils whenever there's a development project. And it's because they are our green infrastructure and our natural climate solutions. They store carbon and sequester carbon, filter air and water, regulate local climates, provide habitats, support local agriculture and recreational opportunities and scenic vistas. So, you know, we're mindful of that, and we took some time to talk about that in the background. So now in just the last few slides, I'll talk a little bit about different sections of the bylaw. So in a general section, we cover how this bylaw sort of interacts with other town zoning and bylaws, understanding that every town's going to have different stipulations in place. So it's a good reminder, anytime you're considering adopting a model bylaw in whole or in part, to review it against what's existing to avoid potential conflicts and to recognize where you may need to, a town may need to designate like which prevails. We also took a new, you know, a look at the definitions, recognizing that over just a short time span, some things have changed about, you know, how towns may want to regulate different projects based, say, on their size. You know, smaller projects may be as of right, whereas as you get larger, you may want to have more site plan or special permit review. We also recognize that, you know, battery energy storage systems have become much more prominent with and incentivized with solar projects. So a solar project often comes in with a battery energy storage system associated with it. So included some definitions and also some other safety requirements that I'll touch on briefly later. Also dimensional requirements. At first, I think we were thinking that this might be a section where we were able to be a little more restrictive and prohibitive, but ultimately, you know, incorporated language or provided recommended language where really a solar project should be consistent with other uses that are allowed in any particular zoning district, but also allowing for a planning board or town to have some discretion and potentially be more restrictive if there's a case to be made with the public health, safety, and welfare provisions. So under site plan review section, we also kept in some language that we found in some other bylaws about having a pre-application meeting, you know, recognizing that these are large projects, they're probably gonna have some sensitivities, and this is a good opportunity for the applicant to meet with town staff and think about, you know, what sensitive resources may be there, what analyses or studies may need to be done before proceeding with the application. We also have some suggested language for required findings. And again, this is sort of making this model bylaw a little more CAPE specific and talking about our unique resources and community's character. And we also have a fairly extensive and exhaustive list of required documents. Again, you know, a town may already have a lot of this covered in their site plan review procedures, but we did want to emphasize and highlight, you know, these are the ones that may be germane to a solar development, a large scale solar development. So such things as soils, vegetation, grading and landscaping, visual and noise analyses, locations of sensitive natural and cultural resources, and stormwater management and operations and maintenance plans for the life of the project. And under a design standard section, we also talk about, you know, the visual impacts that these projects may have and how to go about doing a visual impact assessment if one's required. Some language regarding fencing and screening, again, tied to, you know, the visual impacts of these and using native vegetation and appropriate screening. And then safety and environmental considerations. So again, emergency services, thinking not just about the solar array, but those battery energy storage systems and how a town, you know, town departments such as the fire department should be involved with that. And then land clearing impacts and highlighting, you know, there may be archaeological impacts and how to go about assessing that. Likewise for natural resources impacts. We also, you know, provided some suggested language in there about, you know, potential mitigation such as tree replacement. And then we have a performance standard section that talks about monitoring and maintenance and reporting on these to the town and what happens if there are any modifications or transfer of ownership. And ultimately, if the site is abandoned or decommissioned, what the standards and requirements are there. So that's my presentation. I know I kind of ran through that pretty quick, but the model large-scale solar bylaw is available on our website. I think hopefully some of you had an opportunity to take a look at it. My contact is here. You all know how to reach me. You know, similar to what Heather was saying about timeline for this, you know, if towns want to take this up in the fall, you know, we're available to work with you and your towns to incorporate this into the town's bylaws. Thank you.
Thank you, Jessica. Appreciate that. And we always have time for good information. So thank you. Cheryl, your hand has been up the whole time. Are you waiting for a question or what?
Sorry about that, Woody. I just realized that hand raising thing still drives me crazy. I think I thought it went down automatically after you called. No,
that's all right.
But at
you
the
have
appropriate
a question time, or?
Yeah, actually I do, if you don't mind.
All right. And then I'll go to Elizabeth.
All righty. First of all, to the staff, thank you. Obviously, you know, this is a very timely issue and certainly one that I've been learning about. So I really appreciate the effort. I can't imagine how many hours went into doing all this. I really end up at this point having just two questions. One is kind of a scoping question similar to what I asked before on the other bylaw. I think most of the membership is aware because I've mentioned it a few times. Eversource built a very large battery, I don't even know what to call it, a complex up here in Provincetown that was separate from our solar project. It came later. And it did escape DRI review, but regardless, either way, we were dealing with something that I don't know if we're going to see another one on the Cape or not, but I'm hearing kind of through back channels that Eversource is looking at building more of these for the obvious reason that when we have storms and we lose power, especially in the wintertime, it creates havoc, especially if it's days or even hurricanes in the summer. So my first question is, will this bylaw in any way allow, I guess I'm wondering if did the staff consider having a carve out to deal with just battery projects that are separate from solar. So that's the first question.
Yeah, thank you for that. That is a good question. And we did consider it, but for the purposes of this bylaw, we did consider them as associated with a solar project. So we really were looking at the large scale solar installation in total, including anything appurtenant that may include, you know, a battery energy storage system. And we're certainly seeing, you know, the projects that have come through the commission for DRI review have had battery energy storage systems, you know, the ones of late that I've been involved with. And like I mentioned, I think the SMART program, you know, there's incentives to kind of have that associated. You know, as you've mentioned, like with the exception of the one in Provincetown, I'm not aware of any others being contemplated in other parts of the Cape, but I wouldn't be surprised. And we do include some language that, you know, it's in kind of our italicized sort of a note language that if a town is aware of or is thinking that these may be coming down the line, there is some model language actually that we looked at from New York State that considers a bylaw just for standalone battery energy storage systems. And we borrowed a little bit of that language for the sections that we did talk about battery energy storage in ours. So yeah, to answer your question, like right now, we don't have a separate standalone bylaw, but it's certainly something that could be developed if there seemed to be a real need for that on the Cape.
Thank you. And my second question is probably a lot easier. Could you just illuminate all of us as to what the process is next for this proposed bylaw? Is there, for example, going to be any kind of public process? And how do we, you know, bring in, for example, the various town planners for their input? Thank you.
Yeah, so we're just talking about that. I mean, the information just went up on our website, so it's available. We may, you know, put some sort of communication out there about its availability. You know, we did, as I mentioned, this is a product of, well, both we worked on this under the same grant that Heather referred to, but also, you know, in recognition that it was the recommendation from the Climate Action Plan. So the stakeholders that were involved in the Climate Action Plan are really interested in this and will likely, you know, be bringing this before the towns as well. So, you know, we don't have a specific plan for getting it out there. And unlike the coastal resiliency bylaw, where there were, you know, four towns that we were specifically working with, this is, you know, more generic for all towns on Cape Cod. There's not a specific town that we developed this model for. So it's really a matter of if towns are interested, you know, through communications channels, hopefully they'll hear about it and come to us. And, you know, certainly through you all, if you're interested, we can engage with you and your town planning boards and others to start looking at it.
Okay, I guess last thing I wanna do is put more work on anybody, but, like I said, this is kind of new to me in terms of, you know, proposed bylaws for the towns to consider accepting individually. If at some point folks are interested, even just having a public hearing on it where we invite all the town planners and the public to weigh in. Frankly, yes, it would probably be cumbersome because it's such a, you know, broad topic, but it probably would be pretty educational, you know, for all of us that sit on these DRIs. So thank you. Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
Elizabeth, and then we'll go to Dick.
Thank you. Thank you for your presentation, Jessica. It sounds like we're setting ourselves up for warring climate action scenarios if we're allowing large-scale or even small-scale solar installations on pristine land that has to be cleared. I mean, it's critical to keep our forests. And if a town wanted to be very stringent about it and require use of parking lots or buildings or other brownfields, is the Attorney General going to disallow some sort of article like that, or would the state disallow it too? I mean, what are the possibilities? It's very sad to see these two areas so, you know, butted up together. And solar is very important, but so is the retention of all of the forest that we have left, which isn't much. So where do you think this is going to go?
Yeah, it's a great question. And, you know, it really just reiterates the kind of conflict and tension that's sort of building around this. And it's not just here, you know, and it's certainly not just the Cape, certainly other parts of the state just off Cape. In fact, I've already been pinged by folks in Wareham and Carver that are interested in this model bylaw because they're really dealing with a lot of large, very large scale solar, even compared to the ones we've seen here. So it is an important topic. And also at the state level, I do know through there is a bit of a disconnect even in their own, you know, roadmap that they acknowledge that we need more solar and they acknowledge that we need to protect our natural and working land. So I know that there are some working groups out there that are trying to work on, you know, aligning those two things. So I don't have a simple answer for you. It's just kind of, it is a tension that everyone is kind of aware of and is trying to work towards through things like, you know, our planning exercise that we did in developing the solar screening tool. That's actually been, you know, something that we've shared with the state, and the state, my understanding, is working on something similar, and other, you know, land protection agencies, Mass Audubon in particular, you know, trying to do those sorts of mapping assessments to find the locations like those larger built parcels or buildings and parking lots where it, you know, is more appropriate, and to try to also work on incentivizing those more, because a lot of developers will come in, and I know you've all heard this, and saying that, you know, those are more expensive. So that's another, you know, avenue for looking into how to address that issue is, you know, how to decrease those soft costs and those other costs associated with those types of projects on rooftops and parking lots and other degraded sites that, to make them more, you know, desirable to the development community. But yeah, it's a good question.
Yeah, thank you, Jessica. Yeah, I think the commission really needs to be proactive on looking at this. And when we get in our bylaws, model bylaws or DRIs, we should just be really pushing brownfield use. We shouldn't be clearing pristine land anymore for anything. And there's so many empty buildings out there, available parking lots and building roofs, that it's just, it's crazy to look at it differently. We have to really open up our minds and look at these with the, to reuse and recycle what we have. Thank you.
Dick, you're next, and then Jackie.
Thank you. I had an occasion to drop my grandkids off at a soccer game a few months ago at Lincoln Sudbury High School. And when I pulled into the parking lot of the high school, there were several acres of solar canopies. That is, the solar canopy is a solar panel acting as a partial block above the parking lot. So the parking lot was in existence, but the solar canopy was a very attractive roof screening the parking area from excessive sunlight in the summertime, and when I was there, a slight drizzle in the winter. So I realized how attractive solar canopies could be. And in terms of land use, it already was a parking lot, or would have been a parking lot, which is hardly attractive. I think the solar bylaw needs to consider how we can encourage parking lots to be turned into solar fields, which does not detract from the use as a parking lot. In fact, it enhances it. But we have parking lots at beaches. We have parking lots at the regional high schools. We have parking lots in shopping centers. And they can all be made more attractive by putting up solar canopies. That is a pad where the panels cover the parking area, but don't prevent its use as a parking area. And at the same time, it doesn't require any normal, naturally green areas to be converted to solar. And it creates a dual use for something that's already hardly very attractive. In fact, it enhances its usability. If you haven't seen a solar canopy, it might be worth driving up to a local, to Lincoln Sudbury High School. It's a 2-hour drive, or looking at it on Zoom, on Google Maps and so on, to see how attractive it looks. But I was very impressed. It was attractive, and it did not require any additional conversion of natural space to get acres and acres of solar panels up. So I think the bylaw should, with that consideration in mind, start creating incentives for using parking lots as solar canopy, installing solar canopies on parking lots, and whatever considerations it takes, making it as by right, so that it will decrease the cost. There is an extra cost in putting up the canopy, and there are extra incentives. I don't know whether they cover all of it or less, but clearly you already have the land in some non-green usage, and putting a solar canopy up on top of a parking lot is a very good dual use. So that's my suggestion, that you look at this bylaw and see what you can do to encourage building solar canopies on existing parking lots. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Dick. That's a really good point. And I should have mentioned, not necessarily this bylaw, but another sort of next step. And as identified in that recommendation from the Climate Action Plan, I kind of skimmed over this because this was focused on large-scale ground-mounted solar PV. But another part of that recommendation is to develop a bylaw for smaller-scale projects, such as those parking lot canopy projects, and the guidance around that. So that is likely something we will be working on next.
Except that the Lincoln Sudbury parking lot project is bigger than our large scale capped landfill project. They're not small scale.
Yeah, that is a good point. And scale is, the definition of scale is a consideration. In fact, one of the things that we looked at in the definitions and the different project sizes, because that, you know, that can get a little confusing. They are certainly large scale, you know, relatively, but, you know, we were thinking about larger scale ground mounted for this project. Those are still large and could even be larger than some of our ground mounted projects. So point taken. Thank you.
Jackie, and then Stephen.
Yes, this is an issue that I keep bringing up, but in fact, you showed a photograph with the solar array, Jessica, where the bottom edge of the panels is nearly touching the ground. And the only way to maintain vegetation close to that, the solar arrays, is going to be using herbicides. And to set up, see structures set up so they can't be, the ground cannot be cleared of vegetation except by herbicides, I think would be a great disservice to the to Cape Cod and its soil source aquifer. So I'd like to see in this ordinance a minimum height above the ground level of the solar arrays, and a prohibition on the use of herbicides on a for regular maintenance purposes. And I also would add is, in parts of Germany, the solar arrays are high enough that the cows are munching away underneath the solar arrays. So they can be set at all sorts of levels, whether over parking lots or over grassy fields. But we probably don't have good enough grass to justify that. But you could use goats, for example, to munch away on that vegetation and to maintain it, or just bring in weed whackers and mowers. But, yeah. But don't set it up so that you're spraying large areas with herbicides on a regular basis.
Yeah, no, that's all good points and well taken. And we do mention herbicides in the bylaw and, you know, encourage them not to be used. So any kind of herbicides, pesticides, fertilizers, like we want this to be maintained in a sustainable way and such that there, you know, don't need to be those sorts of inputs. And as far as the heights, you know, I was just going to say the same thing, like that even if it's low to the ground, you could still use other pieces of equipment to get at that without having to use herbicides like whippersnippers and things like that. So we haven't seen as much about the agricultural uses on the Cape, although I know just off Cape, they're dealing with a lot of like cranberry bogs that are putting solar in. So that is something that, you know, we could potentially anticipate here. We didn't put in any particular heights, but that certainly is something that a town could take up in that section of the bylaw about, you know, specifying the heights if there's concerns there.
Well, I think there is a concern, and I think there needs to be a minimum height above the ground. So you've addressed a maximum height, but you haven't addressed a minimum height to allow maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
And do look at that photograph that you showed right at the beginning of the presentation of the panel sitting almost on the ground and the weeds, actually, they were quite pretty attractive wildflowers growing up around them.
Mm-hmm.
So I would like to see that addressed. Thank you.
Okay.
Stephen?
Thank you, Woody. I just want to add my voice to Cheryl's relative to logical next step would be addressing the battery storage only. I agree with her statements about the possibility of these being added more frequently, particularly on Cape Cod. So I think that'd be a logical next chapter to this addressing of these types of projects. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Elizabeth, I'm going to go to Fred. Let him have his bite at the apple first, please.
Sure.
Fred?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm struck by the conflict between, you know, trying to be green at the same time versus the use of our land for these large industrial developments, you know, eliminating all of the other uses for them. When I think about you know, the scale, the industrial scale versus a smaller scale. I think what we're missing the boat on, and I realize this is beyond the scope of this meeting, but maybe what we ought to be doing is incentivizing homeowners so that each person was self-sufficient and we could do enough solar panels and solar arrays on people's homes that they could really provide for their own electricity. And then, you know, that gets into whether you have net metering and whether you're off-grid and whether you have storage. And I realize there's a lot of other discussion that goes into that, but I'm really troubled by these large-scale, clear-cut developments. They just bother me, especially when we have such a need for housing and we're running out of land. The other thing I think about is the placement. You know, someone suggested it was, you know, the Lincoln Sudbury project is one thing, but I think about why aren't we looking at median strips, highways? I mean, every highway I know all over the place has these giant medians with nothing in them, basically. And the power lines themselves, which run the whole length of Cape Cod, which are basically sand dunes and have nothing in them. And I realize that, you know, you get into different areas, but if they're environmentally safe and they're not a hazard to the water resources underneath them, which is we're hearing all the time, then we need to be looking at alternative locations rather than clear cutting forests, which I don't think is very green, and using up the little bit of land we have for residential development, because I think we're pricing ourselves out of the market. Pretty soon, none of us will be able to afford to live here. Just some of the thoughts that I had as I listened to this, and I realize it's outside of the scope of what this project was, but I've been thinking for years, if we could incentivize homeowners, if you could make it cheap enough so that people could actually have their own solar generating on their own roofs, that's probably the most effective way to do it. People would realize, wait a minute, if I get my, I'm gonna conserve electricity, otherwise it costs me money. And that makes the most sense to me. Thank you.
Thank you, Fred. Elizabeth.
Thank you. Just quickly to Jackie, goats can clear vegetation anywhere, around anything, under anything, so they'd be great for solar. But I just wanted to say you don't have to leave Cape Cod to see solar installations like that. Brewster recently put solar canopies over its parking lot at the Captain's Golf Course and across the street at their driving range. So we're off to a good start, at least in Brewster. Thank you.
All right. Jackie, is your hand up for another?
Well, it wasn't because I couldn't get it down. But on the other hand, I was going to ask Dick if he could send us a photograph next time he goes to the Lincoln Sudbury parking lot, school parking lot.
All right.
Thanks. I just want to add too, just sorry, Mr. Chair, just that, you know, I'm certainly not an expert in the smaller scale side of things, but all of your points are really heard and well taken. And I do know that there are efforts ongoing, you know, through CVEC and at the local level and at the state level through the Mass Clean Energy Center and UMass Clean Energy Extension, you know, looking at all of these issues and all of the scales and trying to work on those incentives. Staff totally agrees with all of those things that have been mentioned tonight. So thank you.
Thank you. Jessica and Heather, thank you very much for bringing this to our attention. We appreciate it. As I said earlier, a lot of good comments were made. All this information is available on our website, and you can always contact Jessica and Heather to ask individual questions and to get information on your own. So thank you once again. Anyone have any new business they would like to bring up at this time?
Yes, I do.
Go ahead, Ernie. How you doing?
Hi. I'd like to request an agenda item for a future meeting.
Okay.
Can staff take a look at our Chapter C procedures on citizen petitions to amend the RFP and bring us some suggestions to revise that process?
Okay.
That's my request.
I will ask the clerk to make sure that that's listed in the minutes, and we will bring that up to the staff and get that on to a future agenda item. Probably well past its time to be discussed. So thank you very much, Ernie. Any other new business for anyone? Seeing none, I'm sorry that you might want to leave us, but I'll take a motion to adjourn if anybody would like to put one out there.
So moved.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
Second.
Anyone else? A second?
Second.
Thank you, Joy. Appreciate that. Madam Clerk, can we take a roll call vote to adjourn, please?
Yes. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Fred Chirigotas?
Yes.
Stephen Mealy?
Yes. Thank you, Lisa.
You're welcome. Thank you, Stephen. Elizabeth Taylor?
Yes.
Tom Wilson?
Yes.
Richard Roy?
Yes.
Joy Brookshire?
Yes.
Jacqueline Edston?
Yes.
Ernest Virgilio?
Yes.
Douglas Fromm?
Yes.
Cheryl Andrews?
Yes.
Harold Mitchell?
Yes.
Richard Elkin.
Yes.
Ronald Bergstrom. John Harris.
Yes.
Thank you. And I'm just going to go back to Ronald Bergstrom. Okay. We have 13 yes. Thank you, members. We have 13 yes votes. Motion carries.
Thank you very much. Remind everybody to keep an eye on your email and information that we staff sends to you. It's the best way for communication. Hopefully you're checking your email on a regular basis. And our next meeting is scheduled for October 21st, and we'll have some information about that coming out to you before the meeting, if there is a meeting, or just to let you know. So keep an eye on your email. Everybody, thank you very much and have a good evening. Appreciate your participation.